Hello dear friends, in this lecture we will learn about volcanic landforms, and in the previous lecture we have already discussed volcanic eruptions and various types of volcanic eruptions. These volcanic eruptions were classified according to their erupticity, how fast they erupt, how high they erupt, and the type of lava that they throw out, the pyroclastic materials that they throw out, whether it is tephra and all these things. So we have discussed all the types of volcanic eruptions, and in this lecture we will discuss volcanic landforms, that is the landforms which have been formed as a result of these volcanic eruptions. So let's start and see what type of landforms are formed by a volcanic eruption. So in this topic we will discuss various landforms associated with volcanoes. Various landforms. Now you must first understand that you have already seen volcanic eruption previously. So here also you must understand that when magma cools within the crust, when it is not able to come out due to some reason, then it may cool even inside. So inside it forms some landforms, and when the magma comes out we call it lava, and then because of that lava some landforms are formed. So there are two types of landforms. On this basis you can divide the landforms formed by a volcano into two types, that is extrusive and intrusive. Extrusive are those which are formed by the lava which has come out and has cooled and solidified, and therefore we can see that there is a landform which has formed. But inside it, inside the earth's surface, below the earth's surface where we cannot see, magma may cool and it may not come out necessarily, it may not come out, and it may cool there only and may lead to formation of some landforms. They are known as intrusive landforms. So we will see some extrusive landforms and some intrusive landforms. Extrusive landforms, as you know, are formed from material thrown out to the surface during volcanic activity. And what is it? What is thrown out? They are thrown out in the form of lava flows, pyroclastic debris, volcanic bombs, ash, dust, and gases such as nitrogen compounds, sulfur compounds, and minor amounts of chlorine, hydrogen, and argon. We've already discussed this in the previous lecture. So let's see what are the various types of intrusive landforms. Now, when I say intrusive, it must mean that it is below the earth's surface. But you will see some examples where they have come out of the earth's surface. Can you tell me why? Just think of the reason how volcanic landforms which are formed inside the earth's surface, that is they are intrusive, can come out and can be seen outside the earth's surface. So we will discuss this also when we learn intrusive landforms. So one of the landforms which volcanoes form inside are known as batholiths. These are large granitic rocks formed due to solidification of hot magma inside the earth. So batholith is basically a very large rock which is formed inside. So it's not just a rock, it's a mass of rock. So you can imagine something like a big room or a big building, and this is the structure of a batholith, but it is inside the earth's surface. It is below the earth's surface, and it may be few meters to kilometers long also, and also few kilometers wide. So it is such a large structure. And now this is the answer to the question which I asked previously in the video, that they appear on the surface only after the denudation processes remove the overlying materials. Denudation processes means the process of erosion. So when erosion happens, the upper layer of the earth's surface, it gets eroded, and the inner layers, they become outer layers. So when such processes happen, we see what has happened inside the earth's surface when those landforms become visible on the earth's surface. So that is why we can see such landforms, and therefore we know about these landforms. Otherwise it would have been very difficult to know about these landforms which have been formed inside. But because of the denudational processes, because of processes like erosion, these landforms come out of the earth's surface. They appear on the earth's surface because those layers which were above them have been eroded, have been denuded. Now batholiths form the core of huge mountains. Now when you see huge mountains, you will see that what is lying beneath them, then these are the batholiths. The batholiths give them the base, the batholiths give them the foundation, because they are so hard core, because they are so hard rocks, so they are very strong. So they give these mountains the base. So you can see the mountain peaks, you can see the mountains on the earth's surface, but below those mountains are what? There are batholiths. They form the core of huge mountains, and they get exposed only, as I told you, after erosion. Laccoliths. What are laccoliths? These are also something like batholiths, but they are not so huge, and they are like dome shaped, and they are like a cone, concave, convex shape. So you will see that I'll show you the pictures to understand the difference between a batholith and a laccolith. So laccoliths are dome shaped and they are intrusive bodies, and they are connected by a pipe like conduit from below. So they are not as huge as batholiths. They are a little flatter. They are not very huge. If you say that batholiths are little rectangular or like a square or a rhombus, laccoliths are not like that. They are a little flat in shape, and they may be some they are intrusive, and they may be like a curve body. So often exposed, and they are like domes. Yeah, dome, you understand, the curves. So they are like curves. And the Karnataka plateau is spotted with dome hills of granite rocks. In India, the best example of batholiths and laccoliths can be found in the Karnataka plateau, which has lots of dome hills of granite rocks, and they are now exfoliated. Now, what is exfoliated? Exfoliated means that their outer layer has been exposed, and therefore the inner layer, the layer which was just below the exposed layer, has now become the outermost layer. Again, the outermost layer, which is now the outermost layer, when it becomes eroded, the next layer below it will become the outermost layer. So this is known as exfoliation. Just like an onion, when you peel, there is another one inside, another layer inside, then there is another layer inside. So that is known as exfoliation. Similar exfoliation happens with rocks also. When their outermost layer is exposed to erosion, it comes out, and the inner layer, which is next, the next to the layer of that outermost layer, becomes the outermost layer. So this you must understand, the process of exfoliation. So now when they are exfoliated, when they are, when the upper layers get eroded, and then we can see what lies inside, then we come to know that Karnataka plateau is formed, is dotted with such examples, is spotted with such examples. See, this is an example of a batholith. So you can understand that this is actually the inner part of the earth surface. This was someday the inner part of the earth surface. The outer surface has been eroded, and now this has become the inner the outer surface, and something is again below it. So this is an example of batholith, which was a batholith but now has become the outer part. So only when these these intrusive landforms, they come outside the earth surface, only then we can see what type of surfaces they are forming. And this is a laccolith. As told you, it is like a dome shape. It is a little curve. It has a little curvature in it. These are not very long. They may be broad, and they are like a little curve. So this has only come out when the upper surface has been eroded. So now you will find that this is actually outside the earth surface. You will say these are extrusive landforms, but no, these are actually intrusive landforms, and they have come out when the upper layers which were there, which we are not able to see now, have been eroded, and they have been now being seen. So you can understand the difference between extrusive and intrusive landforms. There is another thing called the lopolith. Now, as and when the lava moves upwards, a portion of the same may tend to move in a horizontal direction whenever it finds a weak plane. Then it may get rested in different forms. Now, here I would like to point out that you just have to understand that intrusive landforms are formed because of the magma. Now, magma is not able to come out. So now, what will magma do? Magma has a lot of pressure. It has to move. It keeps moving. So it will move to a point, and it will keep moving to a point. Now it will find spaces in between these rocks, between the layers of the rocks which are already there. So it will find some outlets. It will not come out of the surface, but within the earth surface only, within that layer only, it will find some spaces, and it will take the shape of those spaces. And therefore the batholith, the laccolith, the lopolith, and the phacolith, all these types of liths, that is bodies, will be formed according to the shape that the magma finds. So in the case of a lopolith, what happens is that the magma means the lava, you can say, or the magma is moving upwards, but a portion of the same, it moves in a horizontal direction. So it is perpendicular to the vertical movement of the lava. So it is moving in the horizontal, and it will find a space, and it will take the shape of that space. So it will develop a kind of a saucer shape, or a concave to the sky body. It will be concave to the sky, to the outer surface. And this is called a lapolith. So you can see here in this picture that a lopolith has been formed. And phacolith is here in the In the second picture, you can see it is a wavy mass of intrusive rocks. So there are rocks inside the earth's surface and magma is finding way inside. So it forms small, small layers and like waves. So here you can see these are called phacoliths. So the left hand side image shows lapolith, which is concave to the earth's surface, to the outer surface, the surface of the earth. And here you can see this is the phacolith, which is on the right side. The image is phacolith, and here you can see wave-like formations. So these are only exposed, when they are exposed only then we can see what is a lopolith and what is a phacolith. So we have done four till now. We have done batholith, we have done lacolith, we have done lopolith, and this is phacolith. There's something other two also known as sills and dikes. What are sills? Again, I told you, these are all these shapes are dependent on what shape magma takes. So if the magma finds space horizontally, it will form a different shape. If it finds vertically, it will take a different shape. It finds in between the spaces, it may take a wave-like shape. So all these shapes are dependent on the shape that magma takes, because the magma is not able to come out. It is inside, only inside the earth's crust, below the earth's crust only. It is moving from here and there, so it may find spaces somewhere and it takes those shapes. So sills are horizontal and dikes are perpendicular to the ground. So sills and dikes are perpendicular to each other, and these are very common. And if you just want to see examples, you can just visit Deccan Plateau and you will find lots of sills and dikes. So sills are formed when the magma takes a horizontal shape, it goes horizontally, and dikes when it takes a perpendicular shape, that is, it takes a vertical shape to the ground. Okay, now let's see this example will give you a clear idea. You can see a batholith. It is a large one. The brown color shows these landforms. Orange color shows the rock layers. And in between, the brown color is the magma, and that is taking shape. So batholith, see, it's a very large area. Batholiths cover large area. Sill is horizontal. Dike is little vertical. It doesn't mean that it will be exactly 90 degrees, but it is vertical. And lacolith is just like the concave shape, which you can see. It has lacolith. So that's the lacolith I told you. It's like a dome. So these are the types of intrusive landforms that can be formed. Intrusive landforms are formed on the basis of the shape that the magma takes moving inside the earth's surface, and they can only be seen when they come out of the because of processes like the erosion. Now let's come to the extrusive landforms, which are very easy to point out and which are easily visible. And soon after the volcanic eruption, you can also see what type of landform has been formed. They are very immediate in their nature. Sometimes they are very immediate, of course, not always. So let's see what are the types of extrusive landforms that can be formed. So craters are one of the very immediate and very obvious type of landform which is formed. Crater is like a conical shape. And it is formed because of explosive eruptive activity at the vent. So we have understood in the previous lecture what a vent is. It is the hole in the earth's surface or in the mountain from where the volcano is coming. So after the volcanic eruption, you will see that whatever has been left because of the remaining part, because inside the mountain, now the magma has come out. It has erupted, so there is nothing inside the volcano. So a cone-like shape will be formed, and then that is known as the crater. So crater is an inverted cone-shaped vent. So you will find that the peak is outside, but the crater is inside the mountain. It is like a volcano inside, okay, through which the magma flows out. So when the volcano is not active, the crater appears like a bowl-shaped depression. So you can easily identify the crater because it looks like a bowl shape, like a saucer. But it is inside, so you cannot see it on the peak. The peak has blown out because of the magma eruption, and what is left is inside, a hollow inside the cone that was earlier the cone. So this is the crater. Now when the volcano is not active, if the volcano becomes dormant, and if there is precipitation, or if the water table is nearby, and if the water covers the surface, then a crater lake may be formed. So they may form crater lakes. See, this is an example. So you see here that this was the cone actually previously, where you can see water here. This water that you can see was actually a part of the cone. but now this cone has been blown out because of the volcanic eruption. So this has blown out. So what has remained here? A hollow, a bowl shaped depression over here has been formed, and now because of precipitation or rainfall or some other reasons, like the water table coming in contact with this area, the lake has been formed. Or it could also be because of the melting of the glaciers or the melting of the snow that is there. So lakes may form. So this is an example of the crater lake. So there is a crater which is a bowl shape, and there is a crater lake. Calderas. Now sometimes people get confused between caldera and a crater, but there is nothing to actually get confused. In some volcanoes, what happens is that the magma chamber, you know what is magma chamber, we have already discussed in the previous lecture. The magma chamber below the surface becomes empty after the volcanic eruptions, means there is no lava left, basically no magma left for eruption. So it becomes a very deep hollow. So crater is also a hollow, but it is not that hollow like the caldera. Caldera, you can say, is like a bigger crater, a very big crater. So the caldera forms at the peak of the mountain, but this can even form at the base, because full inside the volcano the magma chamber is now empty. There is nothing left in the magma chamber. So what happens is that the volcanic material which is above the chamber, that collapses into the empty magma chamber, and the collapsed surface appears like a large hollow tub shape. Okay, now it is not like a saucer or a bowl, but it is like a tub, and that will be known as the caldera. So large craters can be formed at the peak of the mountain, at the cone, but the calderas are formed at the base because they are even deeper than the craters. So calderas are empty, and then again what happens is that after enormous eruptions of magma, so magma chambers become empty, they become void, and whatever is above them falls down, collapses, and that forms the caldera. So calderas may also form lakes. If water from the rain or melted snow gets accumulated in the caldera, it becomes a caldera lake. Okay, so there might be some confusion between caldera and crater, but if you understand, there is a difference between them, and calderas are generally larger than craters. Okay, if you know of Lake Toba in Indonesia, it was formed after a volcanic eruption, but a very long ago that happened. It didn't happen just in past history, but it happened some 75,000 years ago, and that is one of the largest crater lakes in the world, if you see Lake Toba. Okay, so let's see. Here I would also like you to just understand that there is a difference between meteor lake and crater lake or caldera. Generally people get confused. They say that Lonar Lake is the crater because they call it crater. They say that it is a volcanic eruption, an effect of the volcanic eruption, but it is not so. Lonar Lake in the Buldhana district of Maharashtra was created by a meteor impact during the Pleistocene epoch. Okay, so it is not because of a volcanic eruption, but it is because of the meteor coming and in contact with that surface there. So this is an example of a caldera where you can see in this picture, see that this has become very empty. This is a caldera. See, this has become empty, it has gone inside. So here the cone is here. So if a crater lake was to be formed or a crater was to be formed, it will be formed over here, but a caldera will be formed over here. Okay, so this is the difference between the crater and the caldera. Next is shield volcanoes. So now you will see that you will say, what is shield volcano? There is a volcano already. I mean, a volcano is there, but what happens is that when it erupts, its appearance can change. So it can become a shield volcano. Okay. For example. What happens is that they are a little steeper slope because they are composed of relatively fluid lava which have been built over a central wall. So those lavas which are less viscous and are basaltic and they are high in fluidity, they will form shield volcanoes. They will erupt and they will just go away from there, and they will form low slope. They will not form high slope. So such are known as shield volcanoes. The Hawaiian volcanoes are shield volcanoes. They are mostly made up of the basaltic lava. We have already discussed this. So they are very fluid. These volcanoes are not steep, and they become explosive if somehow water gets into the vent. Otherwise, they are very less explosive. So Hawaiian volcanoes, Mauna Loa and Mauna Kea are examples of shield volcanoes. So if you see a volcano and if you see that the slope is steep, then it will be a cone volcano or a cinder cone. But a shield volcano will not be very steep. The slope will be very gentle. So this is known as a shield volcano. So see, this is an example of a shield volcano. Here the slope is not, here you can see the slope is not very steep. It is a very gentle slope. There are some other types, for example, composite type volcanic landforms, composite cone. What happens is that there is already a cone, but this lava is there which has large quantity of pyroclastic material and ashes. So in this andesitic lava, that is that which has lots of ash, which has very fine material with it, what happens is that it accumulates in the vicinity of the vent opening. So if there is this vent, it can form in the vicinity, in the neighborhood, very fine layer. And this makes the mound appear as a composite volcano or a stratovolcano. That is, it is divided into layers. So it looks like as if it is divided into layers. This also happens because of the frequent eruptions. So if there is an active volcano, sometimes there is small eruptions going on frequently. It doesn't happen that there is once in a while an eruption takes place. No, it happens very frequently in active volcanoes. So you can see that there are various layers formed on the cone itself, and it looks like there are layers. So this is known as a stratovolcano or a composite volcano. Mount Stromboli, Mount Vesuvius, Mount Fuji, which are very active volcanoes, are examples of such composite types. See here you can see this is a composite volcano. See here, this has formed, ash deposition is here. So again, layers and layers get deposited and it looks like a strato volcano. So this is an example. Lava plateaus. Now this is a very important landform which you must understand. What happens is that sometimes there is a thin magma that escapes through the vents, and it is not very thick lava. It is very thin, and it also flows after intervals for a long time. So it just keeps on flowing because it is it's not very viscous. It is very thin, and it flows for a long time, spreading over a vast area. And what happens is that it finally produces, it produces a layered, undulating, flat surface, and these are known as lava plateaus. You can see examples: the Siberian Trap, the Deccan Trap, the Snake Basin, the Icelandic Shield, Canadian Shield. These are all formed because of volcanic eruptions which have occurred in sheets, just like sheet. So sheets, and they flow for years, for kilometers long, and they form lava plateaus. So they produce layers, and the magma is very thin, so they may spread over a vast area very easily, and therefore they may form a flat surface. This is an example of a lava plateau. Yeah, here you can see cinder cone. Now this is what I was talking about, a cone. So a cinder cone is a steep circular or oval shaped hill of a loose pyroclastic fragments that have been built around a volcanic vent. So here you can see the cone has been built, the hollow shape you can see here. This is because the steep slope is formed. This is the steep slope. Here you can see this is very steep. This is not gentle like the shield volcano. And the eruptions happen over here. Layer after layer gets deposited over here only. And so this forms a cinder cone. So this is a very steep slope. So this is an example of a cinder cone. Lava dome. What is a lava dome? Lava dome is a mound shaped protrusion, and it extends outside the surface. So there is already a volcano, but you can see something coming out of that volcano, a structure coming out of that volcano, which results from the slow extrusion of viscous lava from a volcano. In lava domes, magma piles up around the vent, and what happens is that it doesn't have enough gas or pressure to escape, and then it may erupt explosively. Now, when it erupts explosively, it erupts from the magma chamber. The magma chamber becomes almost hollow. It doesn't have anything. And when you see after the volcanic eruption, you find something like the dome has come out from the volcano itself. So the original volcano is there, but from inside there, another structure of volcano has come, which is dome shaped. So you call it a volcanic a lava dome or a volcanic dome. So it is a mound shaped, and it is a protrusion. It is coming from the inside. It is protruding from the inside and coming out of the surface because of the eruption that has occurred, because of the pressure that has come from inside. It is a slow pressure, basically. If it was very high pressure, it would have blown out, but it doesn't blow out. It just comes, it protrudes from inside and it protrudes outside. Okay, so this is an example of a lava dome. See, this is the dome that I'm talking about. This is the dome. So this is coming out of the surface. Slowly you will find that this will cross even this height. This will come out because of the pressure, and this will even cross the height of this. This is known as a lava dome. This is a dome in shape. This is a circular in shape. Okay, so these were just basic landforms that I have discussed in this lecture, and many questions have been asked in the past. Generally, questions have been asked about volcanoes, active volcano, dormant volcanoes in the past. Also, they have been asked about the distribution of the volcanoes, where are they located. I will discuss this topic in the next lecture, where I will discuss what are plate boundaries and why do earthquakes and volcanoes occur on or around the plate boundaries. So we will cover that part in the next lecture. With regard to this lecture and the previous lecture that I have taken, questions can be asked on volcanic eruptions, types of volcanic eruptions, effects of volcanic eruptions, type of landforms that are formed, what type of landform will be formed where. So it will depend on the type of volcanic eruption again. So extrusive landforms, intrusive landforms, basic lava, acidic lava, phreatic eruptions, some combination of eruptions. So all these questions can be asked in 2019 mains. Phreatic eruptions, questions on phreatic eruptions was asked, and its effect was asked. So the Mars Lake is an effect of phreatic eruption. So you can tell about all these things. So these are the past questions which have been discussed. In the next lecture, I will discuss about distribution of volcanoes on the Earth's surface. So we will understand where volcanoes are located, which volcanoes are located where, and why they are located, and why certain areas are more active seismically than the other areas. So keep watching. Thank you for your attention, guys, and all the best, and keep studying hard. Bye.